Kaya, which is based on the Narakasura Vadha. And her second novel was Avishi, which is based on the female warrior Bhishpala. She has now written about Draupadi and the power of the Ichha Shakti in Mahabharata. She is also an accomplished singer and has won a gold medal. A gold medal was awarded to her by the Tirupati Devasthanam for her Annamacharya Kirtanas. So I request Sai Swarupa to come and start. We also have a request that she begins with a song, because apparently she stunned everybody this morning with her singing in the puja.
Om Shri Matre Namaha, Shri Gurubhyo Namaha, Shri Ramajaya. Lord Ganesha's qualities. Welcome to the satsang, everyone, and thank you, Kalari Gram and Indic Academy, for this opportunity. It's a great thing for me to be speaking on the ubiquitous presence of the feminine in ancient India. Divine and mortal, divine as well as mortal, which is a huge source of inspiration for the modern women. I would like to say men and women of 21st century. I'm delighted to find people from different backgrounds in the audience. I hope you enjoy today's talk. The presence of the feminine. We are in the ashram that practices Sri Vidya, where the Guruji practices Sri Vidya. I had a delightful puja in the morning. I witnessed the delightful puja. For a Hindu, presence of divine feminine comes as no surprise. As we go back in our history, it starts right in the Rigvedic era. One of the first suktas in Rig Veda by a female Rishika, it is called Abhrani Sukta or Devi Sukta. There's another Devi Sukta in the Markandeya Purana, not to be confused with that. But this is also called Abhrani Sukta. The Rishika's name is Vak, daughter of Rishi Abhrana. So she is called Vak Abhrani. Here the normal hymns of the Vedas, right? They have a particular Rishi or Rishika who has seen the mantra, and a Devata to whom the Suktam is dedicated. But this is one rare Suktam where the Rishika as well as the Devata is the same. Vak Abhrani sees herself as the divine feminine. That is how in our corpus, in our textual corpus, the feminine is introduced as one with the supreme. right? Let me quickly read out the translation of the Devi Sutta. Adi Shankara says this is the first pramana of Advaita, because a rishika or a mortal identifying herself with the Supreme, that's the first pramana of Advaita, comes right from the early parts of Rig Veda. Here she says, I proceed with the Rudras, with the Vasus, with the Adityas and the Vishvedevas. I support both Mitra and Varuna, Agni and Indra, and the two Ashwinas. I support the enemy destroying Tvashtra, Pushan, and Bhaga. I bestow wealth upon the institutor of the rite, offering the oblation. I am the sovereign queen, the collectress of treasures, cognizant of the Supreme Being, the chief object of worship. As such, the gods have put me in many places, abiding in manifold conditions, entering into numerous forms. He who eats food eats through me. He who sees, he who breathes, who hears what is spoken does so through me. Those who are ignorant of me perish. Who is capable of hearing? I tell you that which is deserving of belief. I verily declare myself, this which is approved of by both gods and men. Whomsoever I choose, I render him an exalted one, make him a rishi, make him Brahman, or make him highly intelligent. We have to observe here that this is what she says as being approved by gods and men, which means that the people of the Rig Veda, the people during Rig Vedic times, were cognizant and were very reverent to this fact that there is a Supreme Feminine. I bend the bow for Rudra to slay the tormenting Brahman-hating enemy. I wage war against hostile men to protect the pious ones. I have pervaded the heaven and earth. I bring forth the paternal heaven upon the crown of this Supreme Being. My genesis is from the waters. From thence I pervade through all beings and reach this heaven with my body. I verily myself breathe forth like the wind issuing out of form to all created worlds. Beyond the heaven, beyond the world, I exist eternally beyond space and time. So vast am I in my greatness. She refers to created worlds and not world, so you know they were aware of alternate universes during that time itself, I guess, because we speak about Akhilanda Koti Brahmandas. There is also, I heard about, in another pravachan, I heard about the darbar of the, or the sabha of Lalita Parameshwari. It has got crores of Brahmas and Vishnus and Shivas, you know. Crores of gods, each of them, you know, each set of them corresponding to their particular universes, their specific universes. So, we were aware of the parallel universe theory right back then. Coming to this is the Vedic feminine, and for those of you who are interested, you can Google the Rishikas of Rig Veda and Rishikas of Veda, Vedic period basically. We have Ghosha, Apala, we have Lopamudra, the most important guru, one of the most important gurus of the Sri Vidya Sampradaya. And then we have the Upanishadic Brahmavadinis or philosophers, Gargi, Maitreyi. And coming to the Puranic age, right? I want to take this opportunity to narrate a very beautiful story from the Brahmanda Purana, from the Lalitopakhyana part of Brahmanda Purana. People are aware of the story. How many of you are aware of the Lalitopakhyana? So I hope I'm remembering my details right, sir. So there was people are aware of Parvati's tapasya for Lord Shiva, right, to get him as her husband, and to unite the couple, gods sent Kamadeva or Manmatha to play Cupid between both. But Mahadeva, Shiva, is in his samadhi, and once he opens his eyes, all his three eyes, the person before him is bound to be burnt to ashes. But such was the sacrificing nature of Kamadeva for the good of the world, he agreed to sacrifice himself, and he aimed his flowery arrows at Mahadeva so that he finds the love of his life, goddess Parvati. And as predicted, Shiva opened all the three of his eyes and Kamadeva was burnt to ashes. But from those ashes, the Mahaganesha, who was already present, right, he made a prepared a statue of a certain Purusha from those ashes, and he gave life, and he also taught that person Shatarudriya and all the ways to propitiate Lord Shiva, which he did. And Lord Shiva is very easy to please, and because the guy has learned and chanted Shatarudriya and a score of other stotras, he gives him 60,000 years of lordship over this world. That person is called Bhanda, or who goes on to become a asura, which is why we call him Bhandasura. He gets lordship over all the three worlds, and then his tyranny starts, where he starts terrorizing the rishis, interfering with the process of yajnas, and interfering with the process of havis reaching the gods, which in turn made gods weak and powerless. And finally, nobody could stand up to him because of the strength of the boon of Shiva himself. Finally, because they were left with no other option, they decided to invoke the Shakti herself by sacrificing themselves into a yajna. So out of that Chitagni Kunda, right, Lalita Parameshwari came out and promised to end Bhandasura. And army of Lalita Parameshwari is a all female army, right? The Brahmanda Purana has names of who the goddesses, the generals of Lalita Parameshwari, who led which division. There is Mantrini, who is her strategic advisor. Mantrini is also called Shyamala or Matangi. Then there is Varahi or Dandanatha, who is the overall general of her armies. Then there are Ashwarudha, there is Sampatkari, Sampatkari is the head of the elephant division. Ashwarudha, who is the head of the horse infantry. Yeah, infantry division. And there are different goddesses who have come from the mountains, who have variety of potential, all feminine army. against not all male army. There are forces like Dhumini and other darker feminine forces on the side of Bhandasura also. So let's not make it a man versus woman thing. So initial victories went to the ladies, but then Bhandasura had a very, I'm skipping the details about commanders being slain by the, there are around five commanders of Bhandasura and also his sons who were slain by Bala, who is a 9-year-old daughter of Lalita Parameshwari. And so this initial series of victories that go to the Shakti Senas, that's what they are called, Shakti Senas. Bhandasura asks his minister Vishukra, that guy is a genius, we have to appreciate this, we are coming to the close of the story I am planning to narrate. He observed the way the Shakti Senas are totally routing the Asura army, and then he thought, okay, I kind of got an idea about their strength. Basically, they are all the Shaktis, though, so they are all strength personified. Now, how to break them? He engineered a yantra called Jaya Vighna Yantra. The yantra that stops you from reaching victory. That stops you from. So, Jaya Vighna Yantra, he managed to infiltrate into the Shakti Senas and he installed that yantra. And there were 8 negative forces that powered the yantra. They were alasa, fatigue; kripana, mean-mindedness; dina and nitandra, both are general weakness, forces that signify weakness; pramilika, self-doubt; kliba is impotence; nirahankara, not to be confused with the positive version of nirahankara, is basically a lack of ego, but here it is some kind of a feeling of I cannot do it. So he installed this dangerous yantra amidst the Shakti Senas. By the way, the Lalita Parameshwari and her trusted generals, right? They were in a inside a chariot or a structure made of fire. The architect is also a woman called Jwala Malini. She constructs a protected chariot of fire in which Lalita and her generals are protected from the effects of these Vighna Yantras. So, because of this Vighna Yantra's effect, the Shakti Senas start questioning themselves. Oh, why are we fighting? Have we not killed enough number of Asuras and 7 generals, all the 30 sons of Bhandasura, maybe a couple of his brothers? Have we not wrought enough destruction? Why? What is the use of this violence? At the total right question at the wrong time, which is the sign of impotence. What Lord Krishna calls in Bhagavad Gita, because Arjuna's question is also something very very similar to this. He says Arjuna is not fearful, he is very confident of victory, which is why he asks, what is the use of such a victory gained by killing our own dear ones? He says, Katham Bhishma Maham Sankhye Dronam Cha Madhusudana Ishu Bhipratiyotsyamu Pujarhavari Sudana. Those who are worthy of our worship, Bhishma and Drona, how am I supposed to attack them with arrows? To which Krishna rightly replies, Klaibhyam Masmagamah Partha Naitatvayupa Padyate Shutram Hridaya Daurbalyam Tyakpo Tishta Parandapa. This is despondence, this is impotence, this doesn't suit you. Right on the battlefield, you're not supposed to think about the relationships that you share with the enemy. The time for that is fine, done, over and done, and you have decided to come onto the battlefield. There are armies who are fighting behind you, who have trusted you and you know thrown their lot with you. And now if you are thinking of some self-righteous reasons, it's nothing but impotence. That's what Krishna says. And that is exactly the feeling that the Shakti Sena started having. That's Kliba, one of the forces manifesting herself. And then there are these Shakti Sena thinking, okay, we are doing the fighting, maybe Bala killed the sons of Bhandasura, Sampatkari killed, who was that? I think it's Kuranka. And Ashwarudha killed another general. But finally the name goes to Lalita Parameshwari. You know, how fair is that? Finally the goddess, they have forgotten that they themselves are the manifestation of the goddess. That is Karpanya, that is the mean-mindedness. I am contributing to this, and finally the credit goes to someone else. So why should I be a part of this? And then there is fear amongst the other Shakti Senas. Okay, you know, how long will we keep fighting? So maybe we will lose, maybe we can't do it. Even after killing so many, they have not lost courage. So maybe, you know, we are going to lose, and better beat a retreat than lose any more of our armies. So these are the weakening feelings that started spreading amongst the Shakti Senas. And the generals, Mantrini and Varahi got concerned. You know, till now we were winning, and suddenly what happened? And they went to Lalita Parameshwari saying, you know, something is wrong with our armies. They're thinking about all the wrong things that one is not supposed to think on the battlefield. Lalita Parameshwari, she is cognizant of what has happened. She is cognizant of this Jaya Vikrayantra. And she imagines, she sees the face of her husband, Kameshwara, who is Shiva himself. And having that as an inspiration, she creates Gananatha or Mahaganesha. And Mahaganesha, he knows the solution for this Vikrayantra. And he creates Vighnanayakas, who are Amoda, Pramoda. Amoda is unanimity, and Pramoda is happiness, which in this context could be that togetherness and self-confidence, right? That is what the Shakti Senas lost because of the Jaya Vikrayantra. Sumukha, Durmukha, initiative, and something is about where we need to know when to take the first step and when to retreat, right? That is the knowledge of that is the secret behind every victory. So Sumukha, Durmukha, Arighna, Vighnakarta. These are the six Vighnanayakas who go and destroy those eight negative forces powering the Jaya Vighnayantra. And again, Shakti Senas, after that, they regroup and destroy Bhandasura's armies. And finally, Lalita Parameshwari, she kills Bhandasura, which is an epic battle. I am not able to go through the whole of the detail given the time and time constraints. But I would urge you to read this part of Brahmanda Purana. It's beautiful, it's supremely beautiful and very, very inspiring, especially if you are a woman. You can relate to all these forces behind the Vighnayantra, right? We do feel fatigued, we just feel, okay, probably we have done enough and nothing is happening, probably we should give up. Or maybe this is wrong, at quite a wrong time we have righteous doubts, feeling maybe this is wrong, and I'm doing it, I'm not finding the benefit of doing it, someone, the credit is going to someone else. And then we have placard holders who says war is the enemy, enemy is not the problem, war is the problem. Exactly, the Kleidya, it's impotence, right? Those are the negative forces that keep us in the state of inertia. That's what Bhandasura signifies. He signifies that inertia, resistance to change, resistance to, resistance to development, resistance to progressing towards our own potential. That is Bhandasura, nothing else. this is something we face daily life. In daily life, we face in, you know, whatever is our initiative, whether mundane or higher or something noble. I think this is something which is useful. This is a story which would be most useful to us, most inspiring to us. So I once again urge you all to go through the Lalitopakhyana part of it. That's about the Puranic divine feminine. Now, it's logical to, you know, think that those were all goddesses. They have powers beyond the man's reach. So how logical is it for us to gain inspiration? Probably at most we can pray. We have to pray. Prayers are very important. All the chanting, the religious routine that the sadhakas practice, that's very, very important. But how do we get those logical inspiration of the feminine? Then we have the what we may feel as mortal women from India's past who also serve as great source of inspiration. And my favorite amongst them is Draupadi of Mahabharata, the heroine of Mahabharata. How many of you are aware of Draupadi? So, to the benefit of those who are who don't know about Draupadi, just to summarize the story of Mahabharata, well, it's quite a challenge. It's the longest, basically the world's longest epic story. So, Draupadi is the princess of Panchala kingdom, which is modern day, part of modern day's Uttar Pradesh. She weds the Pandavas of Hastinapura, which is again modern day's Uttar Pradesh, Delhi. And she becomes their queen, and she inspires them in their journey from, after the marriage, they are given a raw deal by their cousins, by their uncle. Because their father is dead, their father Pandu is dead, and they are under the care of Dhritarashtra, who is their uncle, and he doesn't give them a fair deal. As their portion of the kingdom, he gives them Khandava Prastha, which is a totally useless bit of land, not very fertile, infested with rogue tribes of Nagas, forest, unfit for inhabitation. But they manage to make build a wonderful city called Indraprastha, which becomes a very, very rich city, and they go on to perform a yajna called Rajasuya Yajna, which declares their overlordship over the whole of the land, and Yudhishthira, the eldest Pandava, becomes the Chakravarti. And then there's a twist in the story where their cousins cheat them in the game of dice. And they lose everything over that game. Everything means not just the rich treasures, kingdom, weapons, but even themselves, as well as their wife Draupadi, as they become slaves to their cousins. After which, I'll elaborate the scene here in a bit. And then they go on to play a second game of dice, which the condition is that the loser goes on a 12-year long exile and a 13th year of incognito. Even after fulfilling the conditions, the Kauravas, their cousins, they refuse to return the kingdom, after which there is this epic battle that rages for 18 days called Kurukshetra. That's again another epic battle. I feel everybody has to read through the whole battle, whole Mahabharata, yes, but that battle has so many lessons for each of us, depending upon our life journey, that it's going to be a very enriching experience. So do please check out Kurukshetra. And after a bloody war of so many losses, after a victory at a cost of, we can question what, But Pandavas finally regain the kingdom. And their source of inspiration all through is their queen Draupadi and their cousin Lord Krishna. For Mahabharata, it's been said that Draupadi is the Ichha Shakti, Krishna is the Jnana Shakti, and Pandavas form the Kriya Shakti. For to achieve any aim, we need these three forces. A strong will, Ichha Shakti, is the strong desire to achieve it. Jnana Shakti is the know-how of how to achieve that aim. And Kriya Shakti is the final execution, ability to execute what is required. And even Lalita Sahasranamam, it extols her as Ichha Shakti, Jnana Shakti, Kriya Shakti, Swarupini. So even if one of them is lacking, you know, we won't reach that end. Right? And Draupadi, again, our mortal feminine, is more, immortal in our memories, but a human woman who is extolled as the Ichha Shakti of the whole Mahabharata. Because her arrival, it is what we call as a game changer. Right? The story follows certain pattern, then something happens and it takes a different direction. Right? That something is a game changer, and Draupadi is a game changer. Before she enters the likes of Pandavas, they are they are already running away from various attempts, murderous attempts by their cousins. They are living incognito. You know, they are not sure about whether they can face the whole enemy, just the five of them with their mother. And then she enters their lives. She brings the whole might of her natal home, Panchala. And suddenly, Dhritarashtra, their uncle, feels that, okay, something I have to give them so that the whole Panchala doesn't attack me. She's the game changer that way. And coming to the dice game, that's an incident which everybody hopes, wishes had not happened. Right, when Yudhishthira, while playing the game of dice, he loses, his material wealth, his weapons, his brother's weapons, and one by one he starts staking his own brothers, himself, and finally his wife, Draupadi. So, things have hit the rock bottom, right? A total rock bottom. And then, just to add, insult to injury, right? Kaurava say, they have Draupadi dragged up to the Sabha hall. Let her now realize that she is the slave and not an empress anymore. And a lot of adaptations of Mahabharata focus hugely upon the insults that Draupadi bore. And a very shameful incident called Vastraharan, where they try to disrobe her even. And some say it's Lord Krishna, some versions say it's Lord Krishna, some versions say it is Lord Dharma, and some versions say it is Draupadi's chastity itself which protected her, her honor. But Vedavyasa, he has attributed this part, only one or two shlokas to this part, and there's a huge chapter dedicated to how Draupadi questions the validity of this game and finally brings everything back to square one. Then even in that trying condition, right, she starts with a lot of shameful incidents happen, but let me not lose my sense of propriety. So she starts, salutations to everyone, especially the elders in the Sabha who did nothing to save me, but still, because it's my, it's me, and I won't forget what is my dharma. Then she starts questioning the validity of the game of dice. She builds dissent, one woman against a court full of men, most of them against her. Whoever is for her is not able to lift a finger to save her honor, but she questions that. And then there is one lone Kaurava who supports her, called Vikarna. She says, yeah, she is, you know, Draupadi's question seems appropriate. Yeah, Yudhishthira lost himself first. He has no right to stake anyone else. How could he stake Draupadi? She's right. And the Vidura, who is the minister of Dhritarashtra, he has been against this game since day one, so he's been openly opposing it. Then there are rishis in the Sabha who start doubting, and finally Dhritarashtra is compelled to declare the game as null and void. So finally he's been defeated, and dharmically the rishis say it was wrong, it was all wrong. Then he asks, okay, Draupadi, just try and forget whatever happened. Let me give you something, ask for something in return, after which we can forget everything. You know, we try to forget everything what's happened and go back to our lives. At that point, Draupadi asks for the freedom of Yudhishthira, the man who staked her. Then Dhritarashtra, okay, how does that help? But okay, you know, since you want it, you know, you take Yudhishthira, but who else? This is not enough. Ask for something else. Like, okay, very well. Release all the other four of my husbands along with their weapons so that they are capable of fighting and giving a fitting response to whatever happened today. That is, you know, that's something unspoken, but it's conveyed when she says, you know, release them all and give back their weapons. She didn't ask for the kingdom. She didn't ask for her lost treasury or her servants or her palace, but she asks for her husband's weapons so that they can fight back. After which, Dhritarashtra is still, surprised. Why is she not asking for kingdom or maybe a safe passage for her to go back to Panchala, or she's asking for her husbands and their weapons, but anything else? Can I give you anything else? She says, no, my husbands will claim back whatever is remaining. She has not even had a word with her husbands, but she knows that if it's her will, they are going to fight for her right now because they are free and their weapons are free. That is the synchrony between Ichha Shakti and Kriya Shakti. Right? Once you have that execution ability within you, which is in sync with the ambition within you, right? Both are in tandem with each other, you can achieve. There is not much of self-doubt or nothing is going to stop you from doing that. Draupadi is aware of that. Which is why Dhritarashtra gets so scared that he's like, you are not asking for something which will, which I'll be satisfied. So let me give back whatever your husband has lost in this game of dice. I'm giving it back. Let us consider, that we've never played this game. Now go back to your kingdom. Let us live like this never happened. Let us go back to our normal lives. That's what is a game changer. Right? She enters the Sabha where the Pandavas had lost everything, and when she leaves, they have got back everything. It's another matter that there was a second game of dice and a whole new story followed. But that is what is a game changer. And then throughout the period of their Vanavasa, after the second game of dies, right? There is a lot of popular misconception that Draupadi signified revenge, and she vowed not to tie her hair till Dushasana is the guy who dragged her by hair into the Sabha, and she took a vow to never braid her hair till it is smeared with the blood of Dushasana, which is also which also signifies a very strong woman. Who can take such a sankalpa. But Draupadi is also a picture or an embodiment of compassion. Of course, anybody would be angry with whatever happened. Can't find fault with her anger. But she knew where anger was not a solution. So fast forwarding to the war, it rages for 18 days and finally the Pandavas win. And the night of that 18th day, right, in the camp of the Pandavas, there's a warrior on the Kaurava side called Ashwatthama, who is so angry that the Pandavas won. He and two of his accomplices, Kripa and Kritavarma, they attack the Pandava camp, and every survivor of the war is just burnt to death, massacred or burnt to death. That includes Draupadi's brothers, Drishtadyumna, Shikhandi, and all five of her sons, the Upa Pandavas. So at one point, just a few hours before, she was again, she was a queen, was the queen who has won back her kingdom. And now she just lost all her brothers and sons because of one man's attack midnight, which is against all the codes of war. Pandavas actually fight with Ashwatthama. He's no mean warrior. You know, he's a great warrior with a treasury of Divyastras. But they manage to defeat him and get him to the presence of Draupadi so that she can pronounce the verdict. And she decides, enough is enough, now set him free. Why? Because his mother is the wife of Dronacharya. She lost her husband. Let her not lose her son. Let her not, let her not feel the pain that I am feeling right now. That is compassion. She knows where to put a full stop to. Basically, again, she's a game changer in the way, she has put a full stop to the raging violence. At a point where the war was needed, she was roaring angry. And at a point where it needed to stop, because we don't know how long it will go on. And she decided to put an end to her grief, and she decided to put an end to that violence. That kind of compassion as well as strength, right? It is the sign of a woman who is an embodiment of the divine feminine, who has realized that divine feminine within her. That is Draupadi. That's my favorite heroine from ancient Indian history. I want to end the main satsang with this note, and I'll be very happy to take on queries, any queries related to the satsang, because I know for some of you the topics were quite new. So please feel free to ask questions.
Story, the dice situation. Do you feel, I don't know if there's a clarification on that, but is it the divine game or Leela within?
There are different ways of seeing it. Somebody who are born like 4,000 years after 4,000, 5,000, 6,000, I don't know, and I leave the debate to the historians, but so many millennia after it happened, we have the luxury to look at it from a very macro lens and say, whatever happened, it happened for greater good. It is the Leela of Bhagavan or Leela of the goddess. If you ask for my personal opinion, the supreme being, whether it is Brahman or the goddess, they have the overlordship of different Brahmandas, and I think different possibilities play out in each Brahmanda. There might have been a universe where the game was not played, and we don't know the consequences. So it's all about, for an individual, it's all about a choice. And they have to pay the cost or, enjoy the fruits of whatever the choice they make. The Pandavas made a wrong choice there and they suffered for it.
Thank you.
is there a notion of conscientious objector in Indian mythology?
Would you elaborate, Kanchan?
In the First World War, there were thousands of people in Europe, particularly in England, who refused to fight in the war.
Yes.
And the reason they gave, their conscientious objector, my conscience says I must not fight in the war. And many of them were ridiculed, many of them humiliated and called impotent, as you have called them. And many other people thought they were very brave people, and I have written quite extensively about their bravery. And many of them, those who deserted the war, they were also punished, they were shot, they were killed, because they are impotent. They are deserted, they are cowards, they are not men. And I just wondered if there is some stories like in Indian mythology or in Mahabharata, which questions the nature of war as not so glorified as
the whole chapter of Arjuna Vishada Yoga. It has very logical questions against the war, right? So it's not Arjuna's questions against the war, they are not very frivolous in nature if one delves into the Vishada Yoga part. And to answer your query about people who abstained, there were two warriors, two very strong warriors who abstained from the war. That's Balarama, who is the brother of Krishna himself, and Rukmini, who is the brother of Rukmini, Krishna's wife. So both were Maharathis, exalted warriors. Balarama may have been an Atirathi also. Both of them abstained from war. Balarama because his conscience did not permit, and Rukmini for totally different reasons. But nobody, called them. But it was their choice, and people respected their choice. Nobody called for their death or anything like that. But abstaining from the war, right? Balarama, he comes back on the 18th day and starts passing ethical judgments about what happened, which is what Krishna objects and says, when you chose to remain neutral, when you chose not to fight, you don't have the right to pass judgments about what happens on the war, because you have not taken sides and you have not thrown in your lot, so you don't have the right to point fingers, is what Krishna says. But nobody says they have to be killed because they are impotent.
Any other questions?
So, sir, I can get your name.
My name?
Yeah.
My name is Sahadev Kumar.
Sahadev Kumar. So you said you have written about first.
I have written very extensively. I am strong pacifist. I feel we have glorified wars for too long. There is a whole new movement starting in the world in the last 6 years called World Beyond Wars.
I think it depends upon the timing and the battle for each. There are a lot of battles which were fought purely for ego's sake, and for those who have watched the popular Mahabharata series of the 80s, there is a dialogue by Lord Krishna who says Veer Purush, or true warrior, should be able to identify the difference between what is a necessary war and what is an unnecessary war. And unnecessary war is fought by arrogance, egoists, egotists. A true warrior knows how to differentiate between what, when the fighting is necessary, when the fighting is not necessary. That's opening dialogue of Lord Krishna in that series.
In every war, those who fight, they always say the God is on their side.
We are getting to getting into a very interesting zone of discussion here.
So they justify. You see, nobody says we are fighting an unnecessary war. Whether it's a war in Vietnam or Korea or war in Afghanistan now, or war earlier, First World War or Second World War. Nobody, those who fight and those who are aggressive, they never said we are fighting an unnecessary war.
So basically, it's like I'm reminded of a multi-faith conference that happened at Puttaparthi, where Sadhguru Dayanand Saraswati ji, he represented Hinduism, and very good scholars they represented Islam and Christianity. It was very stimulating, this one, where each of them put forth their point. None of them were calling for war, by the way. But the monotheists, basically they were extolling the monotheistic beliefs and say, okay, we respect Rama, we respect Shiva, but our God is there's the one God that we are all devoted to. And then Dayanand Saraswati ji said, all that is good, but the thing is, this concept of one God, two God, my God, your God is what landed us into all the problems. And the only solution for that is Advaita, where we realize there is only God, there's nothing else but God. Once we say, there is a God and we are something else, and you don't believe him, you're bad, and I believe him, I'm good, the whole problem starts from there. But once you realize the truth that there is, Brahma Satyam Jagan Mithya, there won't be any need for wars, and there won't be any problems arising out of that. And the Guruji is Advaita Vedantin, so we can understand his perspective.
I have a question. Earlier times, like in our history, we always see a lot of women warriors, physical. I'm not talking about war as a fight, but they clearly have had the ability to train intensely.
Yes.
Physical training. And they have also had the power to defeat men physically in battle. So what do you think has changed over time that today women just find the need to sit around and not be physically active? I see this from schools and, girls don't walk, they get tired, which is all you hear about these days. Why has it become such a...
I'm not an expert on war topics, but what I feel is the codes of war change from the past to present day. There have been, even in the times of Shivaji, right, Shivaji Maharaj, there have been incidents where women were captured and he sent them back with honor, saying, we should not harm, the women are not those against whom we should take our rage on. So there were certain codes followed in ancient times where, a woman's honor was not, mostly not, in danger, even in the time of war. But as invasion after invasion happened, the honor of women became an endangered thing, which is why I think, people would have started, limiting the movement of women. And it's high time we broke out of that and started training. Because when you say the girls don't, they are not exposed to physical rigor, right? It's the reason of conditioning of last few centuries. I don't think anything more than that. I don't believe in the necessary physical weakness as being some anatomical this one. In fact, in Rig Veda, there is a warrior. My second novel focuses on a women warrior who loses her leg in a battle, and who is fitted with a prosthetic leg by the Ashwinas. Her name is Vishpala. The book I wrote on her is Avishi. Can we imagine a woman fighting with a prosthetic leg? And it's a metallic leg and not a miraculous, not a limb given back by miraculous ways. It's a metallic leg. She has the pain, and she's fitted with that false leg, and she fought with that leg. And this hymn also happens to be the world's first reference to prosthesis. I read it in some of the Western journals, and we in India don't talk about it enough. But we had women of that caliber. Again, caliber may differ from person to person, but I think that conditioning of you know, maybe women are suited to this kind of work and not that kind. I think, you know, not so long before, you know, the outdoor sports for women itself in our circles, right? Maybe sports, she may not have a future. When I was young, whenever, you know, my cousins and all used to talk about making a career of sports, then elders, they didn't want to discourage, but they said, probably there may not be future if you know, don't make it to the top, there may not be future, you know, take engineering or medicine, which is, you know, where you'll have a better career. And one generation back, even engineering and medicine were discouraged for women. And here now, I'm seeing young girls playing badminton, but, you know, when they say cricket, then people say, probably it's a boys' game. And that is also getting challenged. So I think, generation after generation, we just need to fight that notion that women are, you know, weak or physically weak.
Maybe, can I take a question?
Sure.
Thank you very much. I think it's interesting, and I think the warrior concepts are beyond war as well. No? I mean, like an inspiration for how to behave or which attitude as a woman you can have. And I was wondering if you were saying about the challenges and the strength of being a strong woman or like self-doubt and how where it can go wrong.
Yes.
And I was wondering if you see differences in ancient Indian sources between how women are defined as strong or the challenges of weakness and men. Do you see different criteria? What is defined as a strong woman, for example, and a strong man? Like, for example, you said not to doubt on the battlefield. Is
yes.
There specific definitions for women or they or it's...
See, when we come to the Grihastha Ashrama, right, I am not an authority on the subject of the Shastraic subject, but men and women have certain duties. It's not because, you know, it's not that men should not perform a certain duty like cooking or whatever. In the Brahmacharya Ashrama, men are supposed to learn all the household chores also. The same way women would be exposed to physically rigorous routines, but it depends upon the professions or their backgrounds. That's all. But I don't think mostly there is any prohibitive feature on what women should not do, especially not fight or anything like that. It's pretty much open. In ancient India, it was pretty much open and dependent on the individual set of skills and capabilities, be it a man or a woman. I hope we, in the modern India or modern world, you know, a lot of modern world has been shaped with certain undesirable characteristics from the Abrahamic religions where, you know, the laws were very stringent against women. And, you know, I hear in Western countries, even the right to vote came quite recently, right? Not recently, but after America became a nation, for 150 years, women did not have the right to vote, and they needed some really out of the world suffrage to gain the right to vote. And you know, that's I think another inspiring story. I would like to read more about it. But India started.
Episode.
Sorry.
A shameful episode.
Shameful episode. I mean, but you know, such shakeups are required to for us to question the. Inherent beliefs, right?
Did India have like a vote for women before?
Right from the start of constitution, yes.
Yeah, but that is because our Indian leadership was so much inspired by the Western thought.
Wasn't it a decade later that women got the...
Yeah, because Nehru had gotten his education in Britain and he had seen the suffrage movement. In 1910s and
20s. But we started voting in 1920s. I'm not strong on that part of the history.
But you know, that is kind of that's kind of very political, so let's just not head into that space at all. Let's just probably melt in. I was questioning myself, so I just came a little bit late, maybe you just mentioned that. But so we are talking about the women, and also we are talking about divine feminine. So I am feeling there is a little bit of like you know, the sensitivity that divine feminine doesn't belong to only women. This is a quality. But going back to Deepam also mentioned the physical work, because we are Kaleri sisters. We are in Kaleri Payote, and we see that the day by day more women comes to Kaleri Pit, and then there are a lot of good Kaleri warriors.
Exactly, I think we are at the place of the birthplace of inspiration for warrior women, I guess.
Yeah. So, but I think we just also just feeling in ourselves. It's like the war within, and then we are just trying to almost being more receptive. So the divine feminine and women, does it mean that all the qualities of the divine feminine? So because of the nature of the women, you know, all the menstruations and, you know, the circulations in the body and more flexibility and so on, it is more receptive to the divine feminine qualities, which is more creative, compassionate. So this is what you are bringing them together, or when you say divine feminine? So
I would like to, yes, for women, I would always like to believe that we are attuned to receiving the divine feminine. But at the same time, we need to remember that the supreme divinity itself is a, you know, may not be limited to a gender.
Yes.
It's how it's how we choose to look at him or her. So the whole episode of Lalitopakhyana, it talks about, you know, it has a lot of, you know, Advaitic or the non-dualistic incidents where, you know, the she looks at Kameshwara and, you know, she gives birth to Ganesha, who actually could solve the Vighna Yantra. And so there is a partnership between the male you know, element as well as the female element. So there's a sink, if I can call it, and that sink is, that sink itself I call, I think, is dharma. When we lose that sink, it is adharma.
I'd like to interject a bit. Meltem, at one point I was hearing Guruji having a conversation with some of his guru bhais, and Rajivji, I remember saying that if a sadhaka, for a male sadhaka, it takes say 14 years of intense sadhana with that kind of focus to kind of attain liberation. Then for a female sadhaka, that equivalent of that time is 1 year. This is something I heard in passing.
Wow. Okay. So, yes. I want to speak. This is something that was brought up two nights ago.
Mm-hmm.
It's not your proposition, but I wanted to bring it up because it was a conversation about the roots of the binary in ancient India. And it was a really interesting proposition to think of the destructive capacity of the female female form, the female spirit, in response to an injustice on the female spirit, and that part of like the conditioning for the subjugation of women now is part of that fear of that actual, that recognition of that capacity of the female spirit to enact revenge, sort of in the story of Draupadi, who enacted revenge. I'm curious though, again, I know it's not your proposition, but I'm curious how, in ancient India, there is a recognition within that of the divine feminine as having this innate capacity to destroy.
Ancient India, having women present in all walks of life was a norm. It was not. It didn't carry the baggage of Abrahamic patriarchy. So
It's not a huge thing that, wow, there is a queen who manages the kingdom, or wow, there is a warrior, she can fight. So it's not something which wows us, it's something which is a part of normal life. Yeah, she needs to fight, she's fighting great.
Not
she needs to be knowledgeable, she has a lot of knowledge, that's great.
Not that she's a fighter specifically, but that she has a capacity to destroy this fire, this is part of the form in which we, that maybe we can even recognize that this is it, divine.
There were all these ethical codes which spoke about not making not angering a righteous woman,
mm-hmm.
Because a righteous woman could summon gods is what was what the belief was. So it's not about the more than the subjugation. I think it is drawing a line, right? Drawing a line before dishonoring a woman. Whenever a righteous woman was dishonored, hell broke loose. That's the lesson that the history taught us.
What would the definition of a righteous woman be?
Dharmic. Dharmic is the word. Righteous is just a poor translation that I'm using. But dharma itself is a very, very dynamic word. It's not just a code or something, but it's from all the things about dharma that I have read, definitions of dharma that I have read, it's what I like is the etymology itself, dharayati iti dharma, that which contains the balance that is required for sustenance is dharma. The minute the balance is upset, right, then we know that adharma is in force and the universe or the creation is going towards destruction. And dharma is what stands between what is created and its destruction. So it can be violence at times, it can be non-violence, it can be ambition, it can be lack of ambition. So it's very, very dynamic.
One more question. You commented on patriarchy and the Abrahamical religion, while any fanaticism as far as
any
that is concerned is a concern for me, but how would you term the Vastraharan of Draupadi?
That's the defining incident of what made the war inevitable, right? That's the point of no return, that they reached that point of no return, because that is one incident which has been repeated again and again through the Mahabharata, saying, such people should not go unpunished. And today we are seeing convicted rapists being saved from sentence, the sentence that they actually deserve. We are seeing them saved again and again and again. It makes us wonder how important is the justice system. But once ancient times it was not like that, right? That's one incident which, whenever there was doubt, right, this was the incident which was reminded to take off any signs of doubt about whether war was needed or not.
I have a question.
Okay.
We have time?
Yeah.
This question comes from you being a woman, a scholar.
Not yet a scholar.
But yeah, kind of exploring this space of roots. And this question of patriarchy, I wanted to kind of present it in your journey.
Mm-hmm.
Like, probably you grew up in schooling that was similar to probably many of us, CBSE schooling, and then, a certain competitive structure, and you went and did your IIT. And then when you went dwelling into these spiritual paths, did you encounter patriarchy? Were there questions that arose for you and how did you navigate
it? The answer is no. Actually, spiritual seeking has been a part of my family life. It's been since the beginning. It's just that an academic phase and the career phase of life were, you know, part and parcel of the journey. But the spiritual quotient has, thanks to my parents and grandparents and, you know, their ancestors, it has been always a part of life. And I don't think I ever encountered very patriarchal obstacles as such. There might have been some concerns for my own good, which I think most of which I didn't comply with. So, you know, be it about it was my choice, I chose my husband, it was a love marriage, which was against certain social norms, both the families, we managed to convince both the families, and it was my decision to study MBA, go far away from home. You know, there were certain concerns that my father had, that's all, but it was never an obstacle, or maybe I'm just fortunate that I did not encounter a patriarchy in its sense. It's, my parents always encouraged me. Thanks a lot. I think I learned a lot interacting with you all. I hope you found the session delightful as well.
Thank you, sir. So today we call James G, who sees the Shakti in every woman.
May you one day become a scholar.
Thank you so much. I'm going to hold it till Avian takes a picture.
Okay. Give me that.